Yep, so my name is Melissa Gilbert. I am an artist and a storyteller. I have just finished my fine arts degree with honours last year at Wycliffe in Auckland. My practice really spans quite a lot. I'm very greedy. I started with painting, I do activation, I do moving image, whatever fits the story that I'm trying to tell. I move from medium to medium. And so with the lecture here today, I'm going to be talking more about history and subculture rather than like actual fashion. But it all kind of informs my identity and how I dress. And I don't want to talk at you, I want to talk with you. So just like nod or like ask questions, feel free to interrupt me just so we don't have to hear my voice for an hour and a half. Yeah? Cool. Pronouns, they, them, she, her, he, him, gender fluid. And we'll talk more about that in the lecture here. Let's get started. That's me. Yeah, what else do I need to tell you guys? So, to inform the lecture as well, on my mum's side, I'm Tongan Samoan and Fijian. And then on my dad's side, I'm New Zealand European. And so we'll also talk about the kind of Venn diagram of culture in that way and the way it influences my work, my dress, my outlook on life. This is a beautiful quote by Lana Lopesi. She is a Samoan writer, and I'll kind of give you a little bit of an inkling into what we're going to talk about today. So Pacific recommendations of culture through glam aesthetics, allowed into and beyond their professional sphere, are part of indigenous statements of the world over that combine measured protest and luxe performance with a touch of fuck you mixed in. And so, as I said, we're going to be talking about a lot of subcultures, which is innately kind of anarchist a little bit, a bit punk. Bit subversive, a lot subversive, just to kind of get across your identity, because I'm not part of the majority, I'm minority in multiple different ways. So we're first going to talk about kind of the formal aspects of Indigenous power dressing through my art practice. So we've got a activation that I did in 2019 that is called Claim Sanctuary. Trigger warning, this is about sexual abuse. So I had an incident with some sexual abuse, and through my art, it's therapy for me. And so Claim Sanctuary is reclaiming my body through whatever way that I can. In my situation, I kind of disassociated from my body, and so I needed to reclaim it physically through bondage. It looks really gruesome, but it's an act of swaddling. I wanted to kind of talk about the adornment that I used in this activation to bring out and have present the right intentions for the work, because what you wear is definitely bringing in the right energy or the wrong energy when it comes to activation. So, is anyone familiar with the term activation? Yeah? So there's a difference between performance and activation. So performance is acting from the outside in to the person. Activation is, it's already there, you're just activating it from the inside out. And so activation is a more decolonized term for performance, especially with something like this. And so, yeah, so that was about 6 minutes long. As you can see here, we have a lot of like, kind of, not a lot of clothes, because at the time I felt that it was right. I think because of the situation, being naked kind of helped me reclaim things. I was researching adornment. Unfortunately, when you're Polynesian or minority, you have to go to the museum to learn about your culture. During my museum visit, I saw a jawbone, I think it was Fijian, and the caption said, held in the mouth during war. And that I like kind of gravitated towards that and really wanted to express that in my work. This activation was completely silent. I did not say anything. But the act of having that jawbone, whether it be real jawbone or made out of clay, really helped me center myself and the energy that I needed to bring to that activation. I also wore taonga from family and friends, so then I could bring my family and friends with me and that strength that I had from them. And then the rest is kind of self-explanatory. Any questions on that? Very heavy work, but really interesting because it was my kind of first time really trying it out.
Where did you perform it?
So I performed it on K Road at Tautai, during Art Week in 2019. It was a fully femme activation exhibition. So along with me, there was two other people, dancers and some more activators. Yeah. Questions?
Did you find it kind of like find the empowerment from it that you were hoping to achieve?
Yes, yeah. I think you have to be careful with works like this because you can traumatize your audience. You can also re-traumatize yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think I said what I needed to say, and it was very powerful. And yeah, that was like a big checkpoint in terms of my healing. And again, it's kind of like a big fuck you,
yeah.
Which I love to do. Yeah. Question? We good? We're moving on to the next slide? Perfect. And so that's kind of how I use adornment and Indigenous power dressing in a formal sense in terms of ready to show people, ready to kind of be questioned about it as opposed to kind of doing it every day. So, this is Hawea Hukuleo. She is a Tongan goddess. I went on another museum trip just to kind of vibe check and try and find some art to make. I gravitated towards her. So her story is that she is a Tongan goddess and she is part of the creation story and Tongan ethos. So her personality is very stubborn, rambunctious, really intense personality, not a people pleaser at all. And so she is a part of kind of the pre-colonial shamanic religion before it was colonized by missionaries. Her likeness and her sculptures were in temples, and then we got raided, and the king at the time in Tonga held a noose around her neck and held it up to the people to kind of as a signal of assimilation to Christianity, and so with her legend as well. So that's the political kind of timeline of her and her likeness in our world. But the legend of her is that she was a part of the creation story. Her father promised the mortal world to her. He changed his mind and gave it to her brothers. She got really angry because she's stubborn and not a people pleaser and very selfish. And then tried to destroy the world. And her brothers tied her up in Pulotsu, which is the underworld. And so there she waits to be untied to destroy the world. She's a villain. Also, there is a ongoing discussion about her gender. Some believe she is a woman, some believe she is a man, some believe she is gender fluid, which is why I gravitate towards her, I believe. And that can be a discussion for later, because sometimes she might just be a woman, and colonization doesn't believe that women should have that much power, so they don't believe that she's a woman, if that makes sense. So they erase her gender, or her gender fluidity. Fluidity? Is that the word? No.
I think it's
fluidity. Thank you. and so heavy connotations with her. Did not know that. I just gravitated towards her. Probably because innately I knew that. But I'm a very spiritual person. So as you can see here, there's a noose around her neck. when the king hung her. And so the one on the side here is a picture from the War Memorial Museum in Taumaki. I was able to get into the back rooms and like touch her and be around her presence, which was really beautiful and really groundbreaking for me, because this was like a new chapter for my practice. The reason why I bring this up is because taronga is really important. It sets intentions for the person, it can act as safety, it can act as a, for lack of better words, kind of like weapon for your day. I don't go anywhere without her.
So that is
this is her. Yeah, so we will get to that, yeah. But yeah. I love her and I'm obsessed with her, and the fact that she's gender fluid, even like spicy, better, you know? And not a lot of people know about her, and so me diving into her kind of made me love her a lot more. I'm a painter, so I decided to paint her. So on the sides are the physical likenesses of her through the museum, and then that's who I think she looks like. And so, as I said, with her story, she got tied up in Pulotu. Again, my love of bondage is coming in. And also a bit of a historical reference with the noose. I was kind of obsessed with her and kind of I need to flesh it out through my art. And so I did this painting. It's quite big. It's like 120 by 90 centimeters. And then kind of moved on to making t-shirts. I like to kind of turn my paintings into t-shirts sometimes as a mantle for the wearer to invoke the energy of the composition. I found that the people who bought the t-shirts were aligned with the kaupapa. She is a Tongan god, but not all my wearers were Tongan. They were mostly women though, which was really awesome for me. I found that, these three girls are artists, and it really, it's just really fun when people wear your stuff, you know? It's just like they understand it and they get it, even if it is quite intense imagery. It was kind of beautiful. I also did video plays work. A lot of artists wore the work, and then I have one friend who is a dancer, and she's Fijian, and she uses my t-shirt as a mantle for the energy of what she's trying to bring through her activations. Making noises. So shared kaupapa. You bring forth the information and people can do whatever they want with it. But it's just really fun to kind of discover the stuff, bring it to light, and people agree with you or align with you. Yeah, there's a deepening of the content when someone else comes into the sphere and elaborates on what you've already done. Do we want to watch the whole thing? We're nearly there. In a way, the t-shirts are Tonga. And I know when I wear those t-shirts, I'm gonna have a really good day. And people are gonna like get out of my way when I'm walking through town. You know what I'm saying? Does anyone have like a piece of like clothing or like jewelry that does that for them? Yeah, you get it. Oh my gosh, I didn't wear my earrings today. Damn it. Alright. That's enough of that. Okay. Any questions about that?
No, we're good.
So this is kind of replicating the history of the kind of the way that Islanders accessibly protest and like are a bit tongue-in-cheek. So we've got David's work here where he kind of he's a designer, so he's taken like really popular iconography from movies and kind of flipped them on their head to kind of really appeal or apply to his community. And these are his Ōtara shirts. Yeah, and there's still like quite a lot of like, I think, do you reckon he was like the first to do it?
No, Yuki was actually.
Sorry?
Yuki.
Oh, nice.
Oh, yeah, but started this whole movement, so you're absolutely right.
So it's, and it's still happening, and you can find a lot of like tongue-in-cheek rip-off stuff in the markets and things like that, and there's that whole culture of that. And there's an accessibility to that message. It's not a suit and tie, you know?
Sorry, Mel, but Yuki Kihara is a Japanese Samoan whakapine artist, and so she was Wellington based, and she did a range of t-shirts in the 90s, which played with kind of logos as well, and so it just started this wide movement, everyone started hopping, and I think Tupapa bought those t-shirts. It was really controversial, I don't know if you remember Catherine. Tupapa bought all these t-shirts for $50. One of them had the warehouse logo and it said the whole house. And the KFC logo was like KKK. Oof. Yeah, it was really like in like 90s, like Conservative National were like, oh my god, taxpayer money going on to this brand queen artist. You know, it was really, the headlines are horrific. But what it did was it empowered artists like Selena, the South Auckland community, to kind of appropriate and look at kind of capitalism. Look at logos and just claim it. So yeah, it's so good that you've got this here.
Thank you.
Anyway, but you the bomb, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry.
Yeah, definitely look her up. So we're getting to my taonga. So I was able to commission a tofunga carver to carve a likeness of Hikuleo for me. In the middle there, it is my actual taonga, and then on the side there is another version that he has made for another customer. And so he's done it all ethically. He's sourced local whale bone from the local iwi and their quarters hemp. And a beautiful thing that he did when he drops it off to you is he ties her up like the legend, and you unravel her and then you wear her, which is super cute and amazing. And I nearly cried when I got her, and I'm not a crier, so that means it's really important. Yeah, I need to get the like string fixed, but I don't want to leave her, and I hate being without her, and I feel very naked. And usually my whole outfit will center around her. If I can't wear the tonga, I will not wear the outfit. And she just invokes the energy of Hikuleo, like very stubborn, unrelenting, very powerful. Questions?
Was she bound with
her? Yeah, so she was, when I got her, she was bound with the same rope, like her story where her brothers tied her up in the underworld, and so you unravel her to wear her. Yeah, and so it's an act of, like, releasing. Which is so cool. I know, when I got it, I was like, oh my god, this is great. Let's talk about my fashion more specifically. I've gone through and kind of like made my own words for it because I don't fit in a realm, so I'm going to make my own realm. And so the way I think of my style is Neonesian, so neo meaning kind of rebirth or like renewal, so a renewal of old and new. And then I'm kind of like earth punk, where I'll wear like nails, but I'll also wear aspects of the ocean because it makes me feel very safe to have like a bit of the ocean on me, you know, Polynesian things. And I'll definitely wear some docks. I'll go through like goth punk energy, but also bring in like woven fibers, like very churchy Sunday bag, but because it's like connected to like this outfit, it's very like subversive. And I'm not a church girl, so it's very like punk. So before I got this one, I would be wearing these puka shells, kind of ironically, you know, that surfer boy, like, but it's like kind of like changing it over. And I'll kind of, I forgot my earrings today, but I'll wear like a longer earring to give a bit of bowie. And then kind of push it through there. I think my relationship with my hair has changed a lot. I think looking after my curls is a part of mana as well. And although I bleach the crap out of it, I make sure that it's, I take care of it and put some love into it, because if my hair isn't right in a like in an aesthetic way, but also just like in an emotional, spiritual way, then I'm off for the whole day. My hair is so frizzy today. It's raining all the time in Wellington and I don't like it. Also with my tatau, I take that with me everywhere I go, and it's in a place where I can't really hide it unless I'm wearing gloves. And so that's another thing that I take with me. What can I say about that? Yeah, tatau was more, it's not like applying something on the skin, it's again bringing something out of the skin that was already there to the surface. And so the biggest compliment that I got when I got my tatau done on my hands was that it looked like it was always there. And so there's an energy with my fashion to bring out things that are already there. This is not a costume. This is the fluidity of my identity. And also, is anyone familiar with the word diaspora? Yeah? If you're not, what diaspora means is a person who is not connected to their motherland. Is that a good way to say that?
Yeah,
so I am from the diaspora, so I am Tongan Samoan, Fijian and Paorangi. I was not brought up in the islands. I was not brought up with the a lot of the cultural norms that a island-born person would have. And so that is reflected in my fashion, with my tonga, with my my tatau, with my bags, of like kind of clambering for cultural significance or cultural identifiers. In Lana Lopez's book, Bloody Woman, she talks about diasporic fashion, where these days girls get tatau and they have huge hoops of like tapa or easily identifiable iconography towards Polynesia. And so that's a way for them to kind of really put an identifier on them. Because sometimes when you're half caste, when you're diasporic, it's hard to place you. And so that's a quick little placement of like who you are, where you're from, without even having to have the conversation. I've noticed that since I got my tatau, I don't have to like usually tell people. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't, but it's getting easier. Also, this is from Infamy Apparel, a smaller business, but it's really important to champion our smaller designers. And also, Infamy Apparel really champions plus size people, and so that belt is really, really important. I love a little bit of activism, a little bit in your face, can't ignore type of stuff, so. If you didn't know already. let's go through to the Polynesian Panthers. So is everyone familiar with the Polynesian Panthers? So directly inspired by the Black Panthers in America. Huey Newton. So one of the founders read a book by Huey Newton, aligned with it, and decided to make their own party here in Taumaki and Grayland. In the 70s? Yeah. Just like looking at him and be like, yes. And so what they fought for was equal rights During the time, there were the Dawn Raids, which was targeted police towards Polynesians, even though they were the minority of overstayers. A lot of them were European, but never got Dawn Raided. Make of that what you will. And so they kind of decided to make a party. They dealt with the Dawn Raids. They had after-school programs for the kids. They helped in a situation where in Greyland there was like an issue with traffic lights and a child was killed. And so they petitioned to have a traffic light to make sure that it was safer. In that situation, they helped with rent. They protested the Vietnam War. Some of them, they got arrested multiple times. Some of them are now lawyers. There's also a TV show out, pretty cute like outfits and stuff. The reason why I bring them up is because I kind of reference them in terms of like my jacket, because I am an activist. I love to like head back to what activism I have in my culture, and they are a huge kind of inspiration. Yeah, so this is like very Matrix, but also like a little bit Polynesian Panthers. And I love a good beret. Questions? No? And this is the TV show styled by Assembly Salsa. He took some creative liberties, but I do love the looks. It's a lot of browns, a lot of leather, a lot of flare pants. In the show, there's a lot of coily, coarse hair, which is very surprising to see, because usually we are made to straighten our hair or not celebrate our texture. And so it was really fun to watch that show. And as you can see, it's really, really inspired by the Black Panthers. Okay, let's get to the gay stuff. thank you. Indigenous sexualities define contemporary LGBT and queer frameworks. To be brown and queer is deeply ancestral. Western views on sexuality is still in its infancy compared to Indigenous cultures. We can see that by just the terminology in people's languages. The word fafafine is pre-colonial. That is a trans woman. And in terms of Polynesia, gender diverse and queer people still had a role in society. Almost the more important roles. And I firmly believe if they cannot erase you, they will make fun of you, or they make you into a joke. And so, yeah, this is another subculture that I'm involved in. Is anyone kind of familiar with ballroom culture? Yeah? Ballroom? Slay. If not, you're gonna learn today. So this is a photo taken from a ball. One of the categories was sex siren, and the theme of sex siren was to celebrate your culture. And we've got a Samoan to tell here. Questions before I move on?
That's right, by Liam.
No, it's by Becky Moss. Yeah. She was doing this shifty thing with the camera that night. It looks really cute. Ooh. All right. Let's do the history lesson of ballroom. So it is a subculture created by a Black and Latina trans woman in Harlem, New York in the 1960s/70s. So what ballroom is, you can't really understand until you actually experience it, but it's like a gay pageant where you do categories. There's judges, you walk a category, and then you get your perfect tens. And then you battle people in that category, and then hopefully win grand prize. There are houses who are a chosen family who partake in balls. And in terms of like houses and things like that, that's chosen family outside of ballroom. That also leaks into ballroom as well. And so that's kind of like a way of life instead of just being like, oh, we're just a family for this ball, or like for this one event. And so I've got photos of the very famous Paris is Burning. If you haven't seen it, definitely go see it. It is really interesting, my favorite movie ever. And then we have some
like the DVD of it. This library still has a copy of it.
Oh, period.
Yes.
Yes.
Help me.
It's also free on YouTube.
Oh, easy. Yeah. I watch it every like 6 months. It makes me really happy. So, how long are we taking for this? Okay, no, we're good. So because it was created by trans black and Latina woman, that is the hierarchy of who the space is made for, right? Usually spaces aren't really made for them, so it's a safe space to kind of be themselves, express radical queer joy, and the more yourself you are, I believe the more you succeed in these spaces. Questions? No. So that is the beginnings of Ballroom. We're now going to take it to Ballroom in Aotearoa. So it started in South Auckland. It was pioneered by my house father and house mother, Tati Tyrell. I want to say it was brought here or like started in South Auckland in like 2011, so it's still in its infancy. But it is growing, and it's also got a couple of chapters in Wellington and in Christchurch, which is really, really fun. So I'm from the House of Aitu. There were three big houses that were started first. There's more coming up. There's a new generation coming up as well, which is really fun. But my house father and house mother are a part of the first. They're the pioneers. And this is taken at the Legacy Ball by Becky Moss. And I'm a pink blur over there. And where was I going with this? There we go. There's me again at the trap ball. It's about voguing. It's also got a lot of fashion categories, and my favorite one is bizarre. It's kind of like Rebel Arts, but it's more just like a touch of club kid. Is everyone familiar with the term club kid? Okay, so I'm a club kid. And I walk mostly bizarre as well. Here's another ball. There's my sister on the right, Kiara Aitu. And then that's the left. On the left is my house mother, Felicia Aitu. So in a house, you have a mother and a father, and then children. I'm one of the children. And it very much is like we use father, mother, sibling, sister. If you're doing it right, then it's definitely a family. But you know. So bizarre. This is where I sit in ballroom culture. It's just pure creativity. Your only limitation is your brain and maybe your budget, but even then you can probably make it work. And there's me on the right doing the promo for the Legacy Ball, and then on the left there we have one of the walkers for the bizarre category, which was like Alien, which I won grand prize for. So this is my outfit that I worked with Putty, my house father, with. Really fun, very hard to do. We did it in like 48 hours before the ball, but we still won, so maybe those last minute things are the best things, right?
Let's start this video.
Is it DIY? So it has to be, you can't rock it down to one of those shops.
Oh, no, totally not. Especially when it comes to bizarre, you have to do, especially it has to adhere to the category. And they do this thing where they release the categories only like 2 weeks before the ball. And so you have to like figure it out yourself. And we can kind of tell, the judges can kind of tell if you've like bought it or you haven't tried that hard, so they'll like chop you. Let's see this in action, just because you can't really get it without the... And so when you walk, you gotta bring the energy, right? $1,000. I got a trophy and everything. And so that's kind of the boundless fun that ballroom can give you. If you trace it back and do your research in terms of like ballroom, it has actually influenced a lot of fashion. A lot of people snatch from ballroom. And as you can see from like, even from way back with, this is a bizarre category, and this is in the early 90s, late 80s. And you can see it's very dynasty inspired. Because there's no boundaries. You can do whatever you want. That's why I love ballroom. No rigidity. There's me and my house father having fun. And I believe that's it from me. Crazy, right? I just took you through so much stuff. I'm so tired. questions of any aspects of that, or some things that you feel like I didn't talk about enough and you need a bit more explanation?
Don't be shy, be generous with your questions.
I was just wondering where the like ballroom scene is like based in Wellington, because I'd be really interested in going along.
So they're babies. It's really beautiful because they all still like each other. I don't know if you can tell, but there's a lot of egos in ballroom. So I'll link you up with some stuff.
Okay.
They just recently had a ball, and it was the first one that they put on themselves. Sometimes House of Ladies who comes down to Wellington to put on a ball for them and show them how it's done, because it's so new. But they just put on a ball, and I'll send you some like Instagram stuff to follow, who to know, who not. Yeah. Shady, sorry. Questions, go check
them out. Don't be shy to ask questions.
What are your thoughts on Beyonce's new album?
Oh, girl. I like it. She did it the right way in terms of she had chanters from the actual ballroom scene and their icons. It feels like she's grabbing for relevance. Not saying that it doesn't sound good. It just feels like a bit of a reach. And bringing subcultures into the mainstream is always a bit tricky. But I love it. Yeah. Questions?
As a political space, ballroom space is really important for, I'm asking you, like, can you talk sort of about, apart from it just like you're saying, the fun,
yeah.
What about in terms of sort of the politics
So I went to my first ball at 2018 in Tāmaki. I immediately was really taken aback on the way that people are exactly themselves. The politics of it is the energy and the safe space is femme queens always first. So femme queens is ballroom terminology for trans women. They are always put first, and they were always served first. In terms of categories, in terms of the space. And there are trans women who have completely transitioned. There are trans women who have done no transitioning and are only trans women in pronoun. It is all safe for you to be there. No matter what size you are, no matter what you look like, whether you can be clocked or not clocked. Is everyone familiar with the word clocking? It is, if you see a trans woman and you immediately know that they're trans, that's clocking them. I think in terms of the politics of it, yeah, it's really radical in the way that the most... The smallest minority is served first. And so if you're looking after the smallest minority, then everyone else will be fine.
Yeah.
People are very jarred by the power imbalance, not having power, but that's their own problem. And you can just literally walk around with your boobs out and people are like really respectful. Because people are radically themselves, people are very respectful. There's always little incidents here and there, but that's life.
How would you say the ballroom maintains that authenticity without slipping into like aesthetic? Because that can be a big thing with activism. Spaces centered around aesthetic, as it becomes about the looks as opposed to being authentic. Yeah.
Totally. And I can see that with the new upcoming generation. They know RuPaul very well. They know the death drops and not the dips, right? So is everyone familiar with what a death drop is? Mm-hmm. In ballroom, we call that a dip. You'd be red to filth if you call it a death drop in the ballroom scene. And like, I think for our ballroom scene, it's very decolonized in the way of we always consult the pioneers and our elders. So when we are producing a ball, we'll always go back to Putty, who pioneered it, and the Femme Queens. So we're always running it by the Femme Queens. If they don't like it, we will be changing it, because ballroom is for them. So I do see that happening. And like, the judgments of who wins grand prize isn't always correct or like right in the way of the history of ballroom. But there's also a changing flux of queerness, because it's very different from ballroom today, is very different from ballroom in the 80s. There's categories like realness, where a femme queen will walk and they have to be unclockable, and then they, the most unclockable femme queen, trans woman, will win realness. In a way that's really today, that sounds really rigid and like not kind of inclusive, but doing that category in the 90s is really important to trans women's safety. Because if people can clock you, then there'll be violence towards you sometimes. And so there's a degree of survival with ballroom. Yeah, does that answer your question?
I think so. So it's like really fundamentally centered in that space of current activism, as opposed to...
Ideally. We're humans. Yeah. It's a system that we've created. We would hope that it would go that way. Sometimes it's not the right way. I mean, we've had balls where people have been transphobic, which is crazy to me. I'm like, this is a space for trans women. So yeah. Questions? Hi.
I don't know if this is really a question, but like, I find, I'm molding myself, but I've read up around the Pacific scene a lot and stuff. I found it like, that ballroom scene will always keep that ballroom scene because of how like loud they are and how much they own it.
Mm-hmm.
Of like, I don't know, I just, it's too overwhelming for someone else to go in there and try and change that for them, I think. I think that's what's so cool.
Yeah.
Like,
no,
that's
exactly.
Why I love it so much. Liam always shows me the photos and I'm like, wow.
Yeah, no, I fully agree. And like, yeah, there's a degree of self-love because, I joined in 2019, and my parents, through example, have taught me how to really radically love myself and really not take any bullshit and really just do whatever I want. Because who is that hurting? If it's hurting you, then it's on you. Like, honestly. And, like, I think, yeah. It's, my mate went to one once and had a panic attack. Like, that's how intense it is. Yeah, I agree. Thank you.
I remember seeing them at Nesters and just being like, what the?
Yeah. Yeah. It's like no other. That's why I say that, like, you can't really explain it, you can't experience it.
There's no words for it, yeah.
Yeah, no. Yeah. Except slay. any other questions? If not, we're going to move on to Herbie. And if you want to ask me in person later on, just let me know. I'm super nice. I don't bite too hard. Cool. Thanks so much, guys.
Yay.
The longest.